that saved a wretch like me.
And once again, this is the Ghetto Free Press, and I'm standing in front of the City Hall in Gordon, Georgia, and this is the place where the honorable and historic mayor, Mayor Ann Whipperloo's husband, fell sick, from whence he later passed away. And on Thursday, in Morrill, Georgia, I was there as they gave the final committal back to Mother Earth, to that honorable man and the mother and the father . And so today I want to say to you that I picked up the Wilkinson County Post, and the headlines read, Basil Lou laid rest in Morrill. Basil Lou laid rest in Morrill, Georgia. And of course, there's a picture of this giant of a man. I want to say to all the citizens of Gordon and Macon and throughout the state of Georgia and around the United States and foreign nations who knew Mr. Bazalew, it's amazing that little real news coverage has been given concerning the death of Bazalew. But that's not why I'm here. I'm gonna be very brief in this clip. We just had memorial service today in Macon at a local church. And people came and they gave expressions of this man, the one who was worried about Mayor Ann Whipple's health because of all of the accusations have been made against her, such as stalking, violating Open Records Act, sunshine laws, taking on issues about contracts and getting three bids, disruptions at public meetings, lies on her sister, as we are told, just lies, lies, lies. And so Mr. Lou talked to me quite frequently, and he was concerned about the health of the mayor. And he thought that the stress, undue stress that they were placing upon her could cause her to have a stroke or worse. If you remember, he used to come to these meetings, city council meeting over here. And if you notice, he would get up and walk out often because he said he couldn't take it the way those demons was treating his wife. That's what he said. And he talked about, he called them by name. Mr. Lou wanted to get vocal and he wanted to do something that many of you want to do. But something restrained him. But I just want to leave this with you. Somewhere I read, and I believe it with everything that is within me, God is not mocked, for whatsoever man sow, that shall he also reap. David perhaps said it best, touch not mine anointed and do my prophets no harm. There's another scripture in the Old Testament, the 35th Psalm, say, plead my cause, O Lord. Fight against them that fight against me. Take hold of shield and buckle and stand up for my health. And the rest of it has been proven over and over again in the black community. In every obstacle that stood in the way of our forward mobility. Now, in closing, the mayor told me a few minutes ago that they would not have a meeting at City Hall or the Annex Monday night. She said that she wants time to grieve and give a little bit more respect to her husband. And so she said she would not be at Monday night's meeting. And she said she called and told the clerk, Gordon City clerk, that there would not be a meeting. And she told me, and I quote, the clerk told her that we will be having a meeting. Well, all I'm going to say about that is this. Jesus said, love your neighbor as you love yourself. Jesus also said, be careful how you entertain strangers, for many have entertained angels unaware. No. Jesus said this. This is the scripture I want to quote. Jesus said, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. Jesus went on to say, if you mistreat the least of these, my brethren, if you mistreat one of these little ones, then you also do it unto me. And so you may not like the mayor that the people voted in under our form of government, but should not she serve her tenure as all other mayors? It's kind of like the 44th president of the United States. We had 43 other all-white male presidents. Some of them we couldn't even vote for. Some we did vote for. And we have never seen a president in the history of this nation treated in the manner of President Barack Obama. So I'm gonna say to you, beware as they try to circumvent the power of the vote, removing mayors from office, along with many other strange things. So, Madam Mayor, if you're not here Monday night, we understand. And if another council member or another mayor in the state of Georgia lose a loved one, we want them to be able to say, we give you time to grieve and we can wait a few more days before we have another meeting. Especially when the mayor said, I think I'll postpone this meeting. But you see, because the city is so divided, the coalition that I'm told has 4 votes. All you have to do is look at the videos. And you can tell, I'm not talking about 4 people. I'm talking about 3 people always vote the same way. One may abstain, but the final analysis, they vote the same way every time. What happened to the will of the people? And now there's a 4th member on the council. So there's a great possibility that there is a quorum. And since they all seem to be in sync, they all seem to be in sync based upon the video that anybody in Canada, Germany, or around the world can see. And so maybe this is why what they say goes. But the question remains, are we a state of laws? And are we governed by the will of the people, by the elected officials that the people vote into office? So we must ask a question. Are we being controlled by those in the clique and among the slicks, while the citizens wait until maybe one day councilman would stand up and listen to the cries of the good people, not only in Gordon, but the other 11 cities that we have highly documented for all the world to see. It's not a game being played. It's just what God wants the world to see. So don't think that people are doing something and getting away with it and fighting a forensic audit because they don't want the dollars accounted for. The final analysis is this. All this will work. All of this will work out to God's program. You see, God wants to show America something. God wants the world to see something. And people are allowing God to use them. So don't criticize them too harshly. For in the final analysis, when God told Moses that he was going to harden the hearts of Pharaoh, that he would get the glory out of their liberation and their freedom movement. And that's what's happening here in Gordon. And that's why what you see happening across this nation is that God is getting ready to do something. Ah, you may not believe in the God of our ancestors, but we have seen it over and over again. So I came today to tell you that the mayor says she would not be at the meeting. She need time to pay respect and grieve because she just lost her husband. Some people don't think that this mother who have children, who have brothers that served on foreign battlefields, they don't think this mother should have the right to say as the CEO of a city, let's just wait a few more days and we'll get back to the people's business because that's what I was elected to do. Madam Mayor, I say to you, I haven't seen that much news, media suppression, as I have seen with you and your husband. But I'm going to continue to say it because Jesus said it. St. John 8:32 says, "And ye shall know the truth, and that the truth shall set and make you free." And without truth, there can be no freedom. Once again, the Wilkerson County Post won some awards. And I will notice, and I will tell you that I've noticed, that in many southern states, newspapers that black African Americans feel that does not serve their needs. But they are the newspapers that walk away all, with all the awards from the Georgia Free Press Association. So they may get awards, but we know the truth. We know the truth. We know the truth. And because we know the truth, we're going to teach it to our children. So our children would not have to go through what we went through. Once again, the Get To Free Press. I'm George Boston Rhymes. I'm doing what I'm doing because I was called to do it. Just like you was called to stand up if you are Christian, Muslim, Jew, Hindu, or simply you. You either stand up against the wrong or stop lying and say you're standing up for the right. You cannot stand up for the right and ignore the wrong. This is the Get To Free Press. We do this because all of us cannot, must not go to sleep at the wheel. And this includes the new Attorney General Lynch. You know what is going on. All you have to do is go back and look in your archival record under Eric Holder and before. And I'm going to say again, and I'm going to continue to say it, I don't feel that no black person in America should serve in the United States Armed Forces as long as they can treat black mayors and remove them from office and disrespect them as they are doing today in the state of Georgia, while the whole nation, 60 Minutes, 48 Hours, Dateline, Yo Line, MSNBC, all of them turned their heads the other way. But that's okay. Somewhere I read, God said, "I have no respect of persons, for what I say unto one, I say unto all, and that is to love ye one another." Bye-bye. Go.
Me to I want no more. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy.
Officials who are here, and I just want to not be remiss with all the people who are on the dais up here. I know that they are ministers and superintendents and ministers' wives and what have you, and I just want them to understand, if you are not on the dais, if you are a minister, superintendent, or what have you, we ask that you would stand at this time so that Mary Lou can see the kind of warmth that have come to share with you. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. We're going to have a solo from Mr. Richard Hunt. Will be followed by the eulogy, Elder Stephen Whipple, Sr. And I'm going to ask the choir to follow that with "Someday I'm Going Where Jesus Is." Amen.
Amen. Let the church say amen.
Amen.
Amen again.
Amen.
Amen. We truly honor the Lord for being here on today. We give honor to, amen, all of the pulpit company, to this great family. We thank God for you, to Mary Lou. God bless you. If it was up to her, I'd be doing a concert today, but I'm not going to. Amen. But amen, how many know that every praise is to our God?
Come on now.
Amen. I need y'all to help me. Amen. We're going to celebrate. Is that all right?
All right.
Every praise is to our God. Every word of worship with one of friends.
Yes, Lord. yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Oh, Lord, not my will, Lord. Oh, God, but your will be done. Oh, Father God, in heaven, in the mighty and precious name of Jesus, the Christ, our Lord and Savior. Oh, God, we come here today. Oh, God, in memory to celebrate. Oh, God, a legacy in this earth. One of your children. Oh, God, that you've called home. And God, for our knowing him, we come together collectively to say thank you. Thank you, Lord. Oh, God, thanking you for life. The celebration of life. Oh, God, because you said in your word. Oh, you said that you come that we might have life and have it more abundant. And we thank you for that abundant life today. We thank you for our abundant life and legacy that was celebrated all through 82 years, Lord. Oh, God, we ask you, Lord. Oh, God, that you anoint these lips of clay today. Oh, God, touch us, Lord. Oh, God, that we will give somebody that which you've given us, Lord. In the mighty name of Jesus. Oh, God, that we will leave here not the same, but in power, knowing that we received a divine touch from on high. For us, in the mighty and precious name, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, we pray and ask all of these blessings. I heard the church say, amen. Amen. And amen. First and foremost, to God, oh, thanking him for salvation. Salvation that's free. Son Jesus Christ, that voluntarily gave his life that we might live, to the Holy Ghost that dwells within. Amen. To everyone that's represented here on the roster. Amen. The superintendent, Elder Whipple, Pastor Right, amen, and all the others distinguished ones, amen, in the pulpit area. To all the dignitaries that are out in the audience, amen. And first and foremost, amen, to the bereaving family, amen. To my sister, the Honorable Mayor Mary Ann Whipple Lou. Amen. Amen. We count it a blessing to be here. We thank God that you've chosen us out of all the ones that you could have asked to come and deliver this eulogy, amen. You asked me, and I said I would do it for you, because you know there's not too much that we as a family won't do for each other.
All right.
I haven't found anything yet that we won't do for each other.
Yeah.
Amen. And that's what families are all about.
Yeah.
Amen. And speaking of families, we're asking all of the, amen, all of your siblings, amen, we'll ask them to stand. And all the family here, that the immediate family, amen, Mayor and Brother Basil Lou, as I learned that his children affectionately refer to him as, we've always said Basil, but you know, we're from Gordon. We've got this Georgia draw, so amen, bless his name anyway. But we ask you to stand, amen, in honor. Amen, would you stand at this time?
Amen.
Amen, all of her siblings, Mayor Lou's siblings. Amen. I see some siblings out there, I know.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Everybody said, well, I'm a sibling. Amen. Well, praise God. Amen. Amen. We're represented here today.
Amen.
We thank God for you. You may be seated. Thank you. Amen. I don't want to be in your hearing too long today. I'm looking at the clock. It looks like it's about 20 minutes till. Hopefully by the only, on the top of the hour. Amen. We will have done what thus saith the Lord, and we'll have moved on. Somebody looked back there and said, well, what time is it? He said, about on the hour. He said, I hope it doesn't take an hour. They already asked me prior to my coming up here, well, how long are you going to be? And I told him, I said, well, you know that I'm Church of God in Christ. That's an inside joke. If you've been there and done that, you know, we stay there like we like it's going out of style. Amen. gonna spend some time there. We're gonna put, if we don't get credit for anything, we're gonna get credit for having put our time in. In church, that is. Amen. We believe in church. Amen. So, as I stand here in remembrance, I'm a retired military guy, having spent 28 years in the military, and I'm glad to have had the opportunity to serve this great nation. And we've got some more retirees out that I've seen that are, some have served in other services like Marines, but you know, you have my condolences as well. But nevertheless, I'm a retired Army guy. But being in the Army and being in combat, you're familiar with memorial services. That's the unfortunate thing of being in combat, is that sometimes a man has to lay down his life for a cause. I believe the Bible referred to it as no greater love than this, that man would lay down his life, man, for a friend. What a friend we have in Jesus. Amen. But I believe that our brother Basil, I think that he believed in the cause. Some of us, I don't want to be before you long, and I don't want to get too stirred up, because when I get too stirred up, I tend not to want to get the points, amen, that I usually should get. Amen, because I get kind of excited. But there are three points that I want to leave with you today. And then what I want to talk about is a legacy. I've heard so many speak about that. I've heard so much of it, about the legacy that he left here while he walked on this earth. What did you do while you walked on this earth for X amount of time? All of us have something in common, and most of it is that we have time, regardless of whether we're rich, poor. It doesn't matter our racial profile. I mean, we've got time. But the thing is, we don't know how much of it we have.
Come on.
I believe if we knew how much we had, then we would do things differently. For example, I looked at my brother-in-law, and when he came up to visit Alexandria, Virginia, where I was stationed at the time, he and my sister, they came up, and every time I looked around, he was like, "Where's Mary? Where's Mary? Where's Mary?" Or did he say Mary Ann? I remember that voice distinctly, though. And I was like, well, she didn't go anywhere. We all sit right here in the room. Where's Mary? You know, she is. But the thing is, I believe he knew within himself that he didn't have much time left with her. Don't you know, when you know how much time you have with somebody, that you would think through things differently? We would begin to redeem the time, to try and buy it back somehow. If we knew how much time we had. We don't have much time. Brother Lou, I believe within myself, within my heart, that he knew that I really don't have a whole lot of this much. So the little bit of time that I've got, I'm going to try and condense it, and I'm going to try and savor it, and make the best of this, what's been given me. And that's what God has called each and every one of us to do. Because, see, I can walk down these stairs right here and trip down, my time be used up. Y'all can lay hands on me like you want to. But when you sing that old song, when the Lord gets ready for you, you got to move. I heard the preacher tell me the other day, he says, that's why God don't ask us when it's time for us to go. That's why God doesn't leave that decision to us. Because we would say, well, give me a little bit more time to try and do the things. Let me get my house in order. Amen. I say I don't like to get excited because I start going on a tangent, but I'm going to talk about this legacy. And I want to talk about these three points in this time. Amen. I thank God for all the ones that have been here and the beautiful things that were said. Amen. But three points I want to make about a legacy. And I want to read from these scriptures, if you would. And it's coming from Ecclesiastes, the the first chapter. It said the words of the preacher, the son of David, king in Jerusalem. Vanity of vanities. Saith the preacher, vanity of vanities. All is vanity. What profit hath a man of all his labor which he taketh under the sun? One generation passes away, and another generation cometh, but the earth abideth forever. The sun also arises, and the sun goeth down, and hasteneth to his place where he arose. The wind goeth toward the south, and turneth about unto the north. It whirleth about continually, and the wind returneth again to his circuit. All the rivers run into the sea, yet the sea is not full, unto the place from whence the rivers come, thither they return again. All things are full of labor. Man cannot utter it. The eye is not satisfied with seeing, nor the ear fear with hearing. Then he says in the ninth verse, I skipped all the way down to the 11th chapter. All these things go on. But then he comes to some type of conclusion. He says, rejoice, O young man, in thy youth, and let thy heart cheer thee in the days of thy youth, and walk in the ways of thine heart, and in the sight of thine eyes. But know thou, for all these things God will bring thee into judgment. Then he says in the 13th verse, let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. Fear God and keep his commandments, for this is the whole duty of man. For God shall bring every work into judgment, with every secret thing, whether it be good or whether it be evil. What's the preacher talking about? I believe the preacher is talking about the circle of life. Amen. Some are coming in. Got little babies coming into the world. And you got some that are going out. And we hope that when you go out, that you're as our brother Basil was, that you're ripe, that you're ready for the harvest, that you've had reasonable strength, fourscore. He's had fourscore plus two. And then went out relatively quickly. Take me like that, Lord. Take me like that. I'm a helicopter pilot, and I don't want to go down quickly like in a blaze of glory on the ground. I bet might better think about what you asked for, huh? Lord, you know. Amen. I'm thinking about my brother, and I recall, other than the time when he came up to my house in Alexandria, Virginia, that one day I would call my sister, and she was going through some things, and I would talk to her on the phone, and she said, she was saying that, so I'm driving now. She said, but do you want to talk to Basil? And I was like, now, if y'all know Brother Basil, when he's talking on the phone, when you talk to him in person, you got to listen to him. Now, mind you, I've been in the military, and I've heard all types of accents. I've heard West Indian accents, Jamaican, British accents, and all kinds. But he had this, I had to look at him and listen, and I couldn't figure out. And he was on the phone, and I was like, I think he said, after he said, brother-in-law, I think that's about the last thing I understood. I really think that. He was going through it. It was just kind of humorous to me. Is that he was talking, though. He was talking. He loved to talk. He loved to share with you that which he had on the inside of him. Then I think that's what God is calling for each and every one. Because God has given each and every one of us something different that's in us that he wants us to share with somebody else. Everybody, as the kids sing, this little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine.
Yeah.
We, that's what God is calling us to do. But what was this preacher talking about? And I say he was talking about a legacy.
A legacy, and I want to focus on this particular thing about a legacy, and because my time is running short, and I don't want to get up here and tell no boo-boo while I'm up here, because I told one of my nieces, she's about this tall, and probably about 8 years old, and I told her an untruth, and she said, "That's a lie." I was like, "We couldn't say that." But it was the truth what she said, but we couldn't say that. And so I said that to say this, I told y'all I'm gonna be up there on the, but the time is just fleeting. So I gotta need to go and do what I gotta do. I said all that to say this. Amen. Amen, but a legacy, it says a law, a gift of property, especially personal property as money, by will or by bequest, anything handed down from the past as from an ancestor or predecessor, the legacy of ancient.
Would you walk a righteous path without the promise of heaven, paradise, streets paved in gold? Would you slay your sister, your brother, man, for another man's greed? 'Cause if you believe that your God is better than another man, how we gonna end all your suffering? If you believe that your God is better than another woman, how we gonna end all your suffering and strife? You believe great God's gonna come from the sky, take away everything and make everybody feel high. But if you know what life is worth, you look for yours here on earth. It's at hand. If you believe that your God is better than another man, how you going all this suffering? If you believe that your God is better than another woman, how we going all this suffering struggle? If you believe, if you believe, oh, if you believe, if you believe, if you believe, if you the sound that saved a wretch like me.
$150,000 that have not been accounted for in this budget. We mentioned that to you at the hearing the other night. We've got to clear that matter up. That money was withdrawn from the One Georgia Fund, and it is not in this budget, and it's not part of our budget. We cannot go any further until we clear that item up. You know, before we adopt anything, we need to make sure that money is accounted for. You know, we didn't vote to move it, and it's not in the budget, see? So you tell me what we need to do.
Well, I would say, you know, concerning that 150, if it has been moved within the accounts but has not been expent, then it wouldn't be in the budget. And so if it's moved from one account to another, that's not an issue of that budget. If it has been spent, then that's something that would need to be taken into consideration with that budget.
It hasn't been spent.
Yeah, but the money had been moved since October the 1st when our year started. The money was moved and put in the general fund in the bank. It has not been accounted for in any of our budget. We hadn't voted on it, and so that money is there. It's going to be an accounting nightmare if we don't do something with it, you know.
Okay.
It's a revenue source, but it has not been approved and has not been voted on.
It really is not a revenue source. It's really just a cash transfer between bank accounts. So it really, if it's just a transfer between bank accounts, it does not need to be accounted for in your current budget, because you're just transferring money from one account into another account. So that would not play into your current year's budget. It's just money that's sitting there that can be used, but it was still not. It is not a 2015 revenue source for you.
So what do you do with that money?
Well, it's just like I transfer between two cash bank accounts. Yes, I mean, it's all within the same fund, so you're really just transferring from one account to another account.
But it hadn't been voted on.
Well, that's an entirely separate issue as to what happened with the $150,000, whether it was authorized or whatever, but in terms of the budget, that would not come into play when you're just talking about a cash transfer.
Try to explain that better to me. I mean, you've got to have all of your money accounted for and voted on as appropriation by this council, okay?
But that is money that was already in the account at...
In the reserve account.
Right. So you're just taking this, no different than if you any other bank account you have, if you take money out of there, put it into your operating account to pay your bills. It's no different.
But it's not listed. It has to be in a budget before that money can be used or moved.
Well, again, I think that's a totally separate issue from what we're talking about here.
How? explain to me.
Because the cash is already in your Georgia 21 account.
Yes. It's there.
It was taken out and put into another general fund account. So you're just moving cash to cash. There's nothing else that's happened.
Right. But you can't move money that hadn't been approved by this council.
Well, that's a different issue than the budget itself. That is still not a revenue source of money. That the money was already there. It's not new money coming in.
But it was in the One Georgia Fund account, and it has not been voted to be moved.
Well, but that's a separate issue from the budget.
So how is it going to be accounted for in budgeting?
It wouldn't be.
Would be or wouldn't be?
It would not be.
If it was spent at some point, at that point it would become a reflection on the budget because that would be an expenditure. Right. But if you're moving it from one account to another, it wouldn't be reflected on.
Yeah, so until that money is spent, it's really, you know, you're at that point, you're just taking money, using money out of reserves, as opposed to having a balanced budget.
But you can't move money unless it's budgeted and approved by the council. It's always been that way, Mr. Matt.
Well, but until that money is spent, and then that would be when you would have to do an amendment to amend your budget. For those additional expenses that are going to be used, that $150,000 is going to be used for.
Any further discussion? Council?
Right now, in your budget, that $150,000 is not being used.
So it can't be used. Not in this budget.
Right.
Right.
If it were to be used, you'd have to do an amendment to that budget right there to use that $150,000 that is currently, or was in reserves, now is in your operating account.
Okay, so you answered part of the question, but not all of it, you know, about the legality of the money being moved.
Again, that's a totally separate issue. Okay. That's not in my realm of capacity and knowledge.
I understand, but I'm stating it to you that it was not legally moved by this council, okay?
Any further discussion? No further discussion? Do I recommend that? I'd like to recommend that we take it.
Tonight I've heard y'all talk about who's on the bank accounts. I've got no problem with it being a person on the city council. I do have a problem with someone being able to write checks who also has all the administrative and accounting input as you have here with your short staff of people. But anybody to be able to do debits and credits to the system and all the funds and move things around like that and still be the one that can cut checks and sign them, that's a red flag in the world of auditing and looking at internal controls. You'd like to have somebody doing the accounting and then someone else writing the check and someone else signing the check. But we don't necessarily have that either. The movement of funds that I heard earlier tonight, movement of funds is not required by a resolution with Georgia 401. None of my clients go through a resolution to do that. The resolution is how you spend the monies ultimately. All governments, cities, counties, water authorities, whatever it might be, most of them in Georgia have a Georgia Fund 1 account. For anybody to be able to do debits and credits to the system and all the funds and move things around like that and still be the one that can cut checks and sign them, that's a red flag in the world of auditing and looking at internal controls. You'd like to have somebody doing the accounting and then someone else writing the check and someone else signing the check.
We have on the agenda A, adopt Georgia Fund 1 resolution. We're open for discussion.
Madam Mayor, may I add a question? You know, I feel, you know, my contention that it's really useless to keep that fund there in Georgia 1. There's only $5,300 in that fund now. So if there's a legal signature on that fund right now, we need to just transfer that, you know, to our general fund and just close that fund out and be through with it, you know.
Just see, my point is against that state report. With all the going on, when I called that Secretary of State's office, there has been money transferred out of that fund, huge hops of money. And I was instructed by the Secretary of Treasury that the only person authorized to offer the transfer was me. And I let her know straight up, I have not authorized any transfer except one. When Mr. Warner wrote the $10,000 to deal and I wrote that note, that's the only one that I authorized. And she said, if we closed this account, we would not have a ledger or a paper trail once this account is closed. There is $5,000 in that account. That account is going to interest very little. But until we get some things resolved and find out what's going on with the money situation, as far as I'm concerned with the audit going on, this is not a good time to close any account.
Can I explain that a little bit?
What do you mean?
What is the audit plan on that?
You see that I would not sit here and talk about that audit plan. We know the audit that has been locked out and coming in here. But I passed this on to you. I talked to you and you see the deal that instructed me. And I quote him. What he said to me today was, I need to get in 2 weeks. I need 2 weeks to come down to see her home to finish up this audit. Because there are some very suspicious and disturbing transactions that have taken place. Now, without revealing what was going on, that's what he said before, and that's what I'm telling you. And you all got called, and all you can call me and say. But right now is not a good time to be calling any account. Not with my name on it. When I had, if I closed this account, which I was told I was the only one can do it, I have a problem with closing something that I had authorized to be open in the first place. My name was on that. But I've had no dealing with this account. And there have been money, because I looked at the ledger, there have been money coming. And for me to close it right now is not a good idea, because the paper trail is not here. Until the auditor can look at it, or somebody look at this, and we get to the bottom of what's going on, the account will not be closed if I have to
know. I'm saying, but 4 months and he hadn't done anything before now?
He's been working up there at 52 and he's been requesting information. What we need to do is allow him to come to City Hall, work with him, and allow him to complete the audit. The problem we're having is everybody's supposed to find where the money. That's a good question. The audit is very much leading when the attorney for the concerned citizen states to the county that we are on the verge of bankruptcy. Now, if we're on the verge of bankruptcy, we need to know what's going on with the money. Now, he made that statement, and he ended in the courtroom by saying, yes, we're on the verge of bankruptcy, because the mayor and certain of her council members have been living frivolously or whatever, they're spending the city money. So if we're on the verge of bankruptcy, we need a report, and that's concerned citizen state on the poster, where's the money? I want to know too. So let's let the audit do this thing. We have a choice. If we want to disengage here, that's fine. But we need to engage somebody to come here to complete this audit. We've got too far in the process to stop right now.
Because I know we're all mind and body here to be on the political committee. And I thought that we just more or less over that committee. Well, I ain't got a microphone. I try to talk loud so everybody can hear me. But my interest in this is I didn't realize that one council person could make a decision on any of those that we got each one of us look after. I didn't know, I thought the council had to make a meeting to talk about and vote on anything like that. I didn't know one person had that authority to close the open account that way. And I might be wrong, but I am.
And you know, I didn't know that either.
Huh?
I didn't know that either, but when I talked to the woman in the office, she told me that.
Yeah.
She said, Mr. Reese, be it known that you are the only individual that's on this account that can authorize transferring money and closing this account.
Right.
And I said, tell you something, man, I had authorized nobody to transfer not one dime. And I will admit, the note that I wrote her to pay the auditor so we could get this thing going, that's the only one I said. I asked, in the media, could we get $10,000 out of reserve and pay the auditor? And Mr. Warner said to me, you need to write me a note for that. And I did. It was not threatened. It's been in the paper. And so we need to get them borrowed. And I was not issuing my name to Clover County. I want to know what's going on with this town. I'm the one standing there saying, they saying I had authorization. I didn't know that either. But once I learned that, then I said, hey, we're going to get a handle on this. Because whatever went on, I want to know myself because I'm involved in it. And I ain't authorized nobody to move anyone. And we're not talking about $5,000, $10,000 either.
Before the end of last year, how many other people were on that signature besides you? I understand that the previous, could I ask Mr. Brown who was on it before?
Sure. Well, here it is right here, the original.
Could I see it, please, ma'am?
Well, here's all the same.
Y'all give me just 1 second. Just 1 second, we're on it.
Me and the man from 22, I saw.
Okay. Before the first of the year?
Nope. She sent my title. I was throwing that on March, sometime in March of 2015. It was changed. Some of the accounts were changed or something.
It was changed. It came directly out of the general fund account instead of being deposited straight to the general fund savings for its original setup. Instead of having to make an extra transfer each time, we had to go directly to the general fund checking account to save itself.
But when you say we, who are we?
The mayor Turner and you and me signed it.
No, we signed it, but I didn't know what y'all were doing as far as the transfer. I'm not going to say anything. I did not know y'all were transferring.
But that, you read it. I mean, you that read it, signed it. It's all I can say.
Yeah, that's exactly what it says. But let me tell you something.
That's all.
My name is there. But I have not authorized nobody to transfer no money.
We don't have to if one of the other ones do it.
Well, the ones that transferred it, let them close. I didn't authorize nobody to transfer, so I'm not authorizing nobody to close.
That's fine. I don't have a problem with that.
Good.
But the record shows that you, Mayor Turner, and Ms. Brown were all on that, and anybody that was moved before the end of the year, back to the last 8 to 10 years when the council voted to move all that money, then they
we voted as a council as a whole.
Right. We certainly did.
Okay, I got no problem with that. As a whole, the council voted. But as an individual, let me make sure the record reflects that I did not, as an individual, authorize one penny to be transferred to any account.
You believe the problem here? You didn't leave the problem. The mayor has to give permission for all the checks, all the invoices. You ever see the problem?
Well, I tell you, I really believe I see what's going on is that with the situation going on with money, and I'm going to be honest with you, and the statement was made that we were taking the money, she's covering her butt, so to speak. So she, if she's in doubt, she should inquire as to the funds being distributed. That, and I can understand that. I don't think it's so much that she's trying to figure out where every nickel dollar's going, but she, if she's unsure, then she's doing the right step to ask questions. But some questions we make an ask the seller without bringing them before council is what I'm trying to say. I totally agree 100% with what Ms. Lee said. She can pay people. When she asked me what was I'm doing about paying the dealer, I said to her, Mr. Martin, you know what you're supposed to do. You know how to pay the bill. You don't need nobody standing in front of the bill. I mean, pay the bill. Now, what are you supposed to do when you get a call from George Powell or you get a limit of $12,000, so to say, light bill? And I explained that we, one week, she said, we don't have the money. I said, what do you mean you don't have the money? That's when we said, well, we got to get these bills paid. Once those bills were paid, when the workshop was ended, Mr. Reese told us a lot. We got to spend our money. Okay. Then we come back and go to court. All of a sudden, I'm going to break a bankrupt. What's going on here? That's even more reason why we need the audit to be finished. On my personal level, I don't trust this man. That's me. I'm speaking for me. Because when I get a lawsuit for this city and my name in there, And Mr. Boone said, I talked to him, blah, 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 and he only presented one side. I got a side, too. Now, I know what transpired with the conversation we had. I'm speaking on matters. I cannot work with people I don't trust. In 19 years, I have never called to ask any legal advice from Mr. Boone. Now we get these calls, and these calls get legal advice. Everything we say to get the information to move the city forward, it's thrown against us, it's open meeting violation. You shouldn't have done this. You harassed her. I have not harassed anybody that's not my name. And I don't appreciate reading in a lawsuit, you harassed somebody. Why not get my side before you do the lawsuit? You was an attorney that represented the city, not half of it.
All
right. And I don't appreciate that. That's my standard, that I cannot work with people that I cannot trust.
Before you
came in and took over as mayor. You know, as far as I know, every year the city has a budget that we adopt in October. Every bill is already included in that budget. The city clerk and treasurer is responsible for making sure all those bills are paid automatically. That's supposed to be her responsibility. Now, if you put something in place that you want a copy, an invoice, or whatever, that's your prerogative to do. But she is still responsible for doing all that. She does not have to have your approval to pay a bill. The city clerk, treasurer, does not have to have your approval as the mayor, you know, to sign, because if they budget it out, you know, if there's something outside of the budget that comes up, then that brings on, you know, different a recommendation that the council has to make, because it's a budget amendment at that time. But she's supposed to pay them without anybody having to tell her to do it or give her an invoice or sign it or hold a check and wait, you know, to be approved. So we've gotten out of the, you know, treasurer's job context by changing, you know, what she's been doing. And she's kind of in a position where she doesn't know what to do. And that's what I'm hearing to say. And I know for sure Mr. Tanner Underwood talked with me, because he told me to call him the other day, last Friday. And I did, and I talked with him, and I know for a fact Ms. Brown is not on some of those signature cards now. So, you know, somebody has changed them down at the bank. They have re-signed them, and she is not on. I know this clock. That's the one we were dealing with Friday, you know.
That's the one that changed on February 7th. Yeah. And we'll hear from Councilor Baldwin. You're taking in the previous.
Yes, sir.
For sure. And that we think you need to play for the
next. We have a nice day, it won't come off.
I know you did, but I thought about it.
Thank you.
Councilor Kelly. The one thing I can say is she got to pay all the bills. I think she should be on all of the accounts so she can write checks for these bills. If she has to pay all the bills, let her bill all the accounts when she wants to go to anybody about a check. She can write herself and pay the bill. If she's been paying them over the years, let her continue to pay. But she's going to have to be on all the accounts to do it.
Okay.
Councilman
Denson.
Well, Councilman
Denson,
I'm sorry.
Oh. I feel like she should be on all of them. What's happened? So she can pay all the bills?
Councilman,
well, I feel like that she should be on them, on all the bills. And I feel like, too, that if we want to be city council, we're here for the citizens. We're not here for ourselves. We are here for the citizens of Gore. And we need to be a part of the city council if we're going to stay on city council. I think everybody needs to do what they're supposed to do and put self out the way and do for the community.
Okay. And I'd just like to read section 4.13 of the city charter. Section 4.13, city clerk. The city council shall appoint a city clerk who shall not be a council member. The clerk shall serve for a term of 5 years and until a successor is appointed and qualified, provided that the clerk shall not be prohibited from succeeding himself. The city clerk shall be custodian of the official seal, maintain city council records required by this charter, and perform such other duties as may be required by the city council. The city council shall provide for the compensation of the city clerk.
That's good.
This is the most
recent
that I have
of the charter.
We get
away with 5 years in 90 or
91,
whatever we adopted
the new
charter.
Well,
yeah.
Council, go ahead.
Yeah. Can I say something?
Go ahead.
I absolutely agree 100% with what Mr. Eads said. She can pay the people. When she asked me what we're going to do about the deal, I said to her, Mr. Munger, you know what you're supposed to do. You know how to pay the bill. You don't need nobody standing in front of the bill. I mean, pay the bill. Now, what are you supposed to do when you get a call from Georgia Power or you get a limit of $12,000 Sober City light bill? And I explained that we, one of you, she said, we don't have the money. I said, what do you mean you don't have the money? That's when we said, well, we got to get these bills paid. Once those bills were paid, when the workshop was ended, Mr. Reese told me a lot. We got plenty of money. Okay. Then we come back over to court. All of a sudden, I'm going to break a bankrupt. What's going on here? That's even more reason why we need the audit to be finished.
Council,
I'm sorry,
Attorney Boone, I asked you for an update of the city charter. This was not included in my charter.
Yes, ma'am, it was. The one I gave you on January 30th, that big thick
notebook
was all there. I've not seen that and I've
read it. Maybe
there's no
copy of it.
Yes, ma'am, it was signed. Yeah, that was one Mr. Ross picked up in the office and signed the receipt for.
This
is the one that the senator gave that I picked up from Atlanta. The most recent, this was 2003 amendment there. You said pretty much, I think, what you just read. It says, city clerk should be the custodian official to the seal. Maintain city council records required by discharge and perform such other duties as may be required by the city council. City council shall provide for the compensation of city clerk. And it talks about the treasurer, nominated by the mayor with confirmation appointed by the council. The treasurer serves at the pleasure of the city council. 5-year rule is gone. Treasurer collects tax and license fees and other money belonging to the city. Enforce all laws related to collection of delinquent taxes, sale of foreclosure property. City treasurer shall also be responsible for the general duties of the treasurer and fiscal officer. The city council shall provide the compensation to city treasurer. But pretty much.
Next on the item for discussion is interim. Our first order of business under the old business is going to be to authorize the completion of the forensic audit by Bill Bassett, except the engagement letter and invoices. Can I get a motion?
I offer a motion that we accept the invoices and continue the results.
Motion has been made. Can I get a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Discussion.
Discussion.
There's a third part in that, except engagement letter. That has to be done first. He has never been legally approved by the city attorney. His letter of audit engagement. You can't go one without going back and do the other, you know. So everything on there right there needs to be adjusted to accept his letter engagement first before you can do anything else. So everything that's done, been done so far has been legal.
Thank you.
standing on this, and I, what we've been debating, I don't know if you took long, you know, I said it took long enough, but they anyway, the thing with Mr. Baskin was it not that we discussed that we approved to hire him. The problem we had was we didn't approve to pay him. And my assumption for that is the reason why he had not worked is because we stopped paying him. He didn't get any pay. So what are we saying now? We just want to delete everything he's done and install him, or what are we going to do?
Well, until it's legal for him to actually do any work for the city, this contract was signed by the mayor on 2/16, I think. I can't read it. It paid it out pretty bad. But this was never voted on, you know, the letter of engagement. It's never been brought before this council to be voted on.
Well, Council, and to add to that, my statement to that was, have y'all ever voted on anyone's engagement letter? Because I was told that when the attorney was retained, there was no engagement letter. There's never been an engagement letter, even with Roger White. So you might want to clarify that up.
I'm not going to talk about any of the other ones. The motion now is talking about this one particular audit that Mr. Bass did, you know, so you can't, don't get off the subject with anything else, you know. So we need to stick with just this one item right now, you know.
That is the motion is been open, so we have the engagement letter for us, so now it's up to us to go ahead and decide.
Doing this engagement letter over, my question is, Mr. Eagle, are we going to let him pick up where he left off? Or are we planning on starting over saying that everything he done to this point is not relevant? So we have to pick up once we accept this and move forward, if that be the case.
I don't have a good answer for that. You know, to be honest with you, I tell them not just answer. I'll talk in here without, you know, put a lot more thought in it or get some more legal advice on where we at with that.
I don't have a problem except litigation based on the fact that it's retroactive, that we continue to accept what he's done and pick up and go from that. That's where I think.
The other question I have is, this engagement letter does not have anything signed off by any attorney. The city charter said it has to be reviewed by the city attorney. And on Big Word the 16th of this year, Boone Scott and Boone were the legal attorneys, and it was never approved by them. So the question I have is how we're going to back up now to that point, you know, and get it legalized when she's already signed it today. You know?
Open record request to get Mr. Baskin's letter, okay? your attorney to read it. Not a legitimate circumstance. It should have honored. I'm not here to debate merits with it passed or not. It doesn't matter to me as long as it was in order and this council voted on it. That's y'all's decision about that. As long as it's a valid letter of engagement, those things are pretty standard. You know, it's not my job to second guess the council on what they're going to do. Mr. Baskin was the one who would talk to us, I mean. Be clear about it. There's some other issues with his work. That's not up to me, that's up to God. So,
Council, any further discussion? If not, motion has been made to discussion, and now we're ready to take a vote.
Roll call vote again.
Yes. Okay. All in favor of accepting the engagement letter, let me hear about a word of aye. Roll call, I'm sorry.
Terry Reese, yes.
Terry Eady abstain.
Ready to dance with abstain.
Talk about this more so we can get a better feel on this and make sure we know everything that's legal and so that the next meeting. I don't disapprove of the audit. I think you need it, but like I said, I think that we should just maybe take it to the next meeting so that we can all get a better feel of it. And that we can we know what we're signing because we don't want to sign anything and it come back to hit us in the face. We want to sign it and we want to be right when
we just be willing to take it.
Yes.
We'll just take it to the next.
Signatures on the check. And I was hoping that we would have had at least one or two of the council people show up so we could have had a legal meeting so that we could vote to put other signatures on the card so that we could get the payroll sign, the splash sign. We're still having trouble as of this minute, you know, getting the check signed. Ms. Toles has refused to sign Mr. Roberts' check that he is owed $40,215.56 right now for his work that he has done on the account for the sewage upgrade. And so my intentions was to try to get myself or Mr. Freddie Denby on the account, but we never had a quorum, so we could not vote on it. That's the total reason that the bank account was listed on there.
I had signed one check for $40,000, and then the next week another check came for $40,000. I was not gonna sign. I was not gonna sign the same check twice. Who get paid $80,000 in 2 weeks? I was not gonna sign two checks. No, I didn't sign another one. Yeah, I signed one. No, I was not signing another check. The same identical check going to the same identical place. I had just signed one check for $40,000. And I was not signing that same check again. That would have made $80,000. I was not going to do that.
Yes, ma'am, I have. If I could, you know, I'd like to present the information that has been presented by Ms. Georgia Electric, who is the one that did it. His total bid was $132,100. We paid him one check for $50,284.44. The next check for the
work. Excuse me, Council. Was all of the council members aware of that?
Yes, ma'am.
Do they have a copy?
Yes, ma'am. All of this was put in, all the boxes that came in. And, you know, we bid it on this contract last year, and I think on March the 7th, you signed off on it so he could start work. He and Sidney Piles on the CDBG.
No, I'm asking, are the newly elected council members, were they given a copy of
all of this? All of this was just came in just recently, yes, ma'am.
Well, if it just came in recently, then they have not had a chance to review that and look at that and know what it's all about.
It's a standard, right, it's a standard contract. When the paperwork comes in, it's already been approved. We approved it when we voted to accept his bid on that job. And if he completes his work by the contract, then we are obligated to pay him as he finishes the work. When he turns it into our engineer and they sign off on it, the city council has already approved it. We don't have to go back and approve it a second time. The only thing that happens is the person who is in charge of signing that check would sign off on it. And I have all three different copies of where he got the first two checks. This is the third check, and it's not the same check. It's a different check that finishes up. Yes, ma'am.
Let me ask them, were you all made aware of that? Are you knowledgeable about that, Councilman?
No. But I would like to say, Councilman Eady, you say that you have a hard time. I have came in since about getting checks signed, and Mr. Wonder can vouch for this too. I have came in at different times and asked, do I need to sign any checks?
Yes, ma'am.
And it was your choice and Council Densley's choice not to be put on these signature cards in the beginning. If you was Mayor Pro Tem, you should have, you were Mayor Pro Tem, you should have been able to sign anything. You know, but you all, that was y'all the one that refused to sign anything.
The mayor herself put the signature cards together. Myself and Mr. Freddie Denson was never asked. Mr. Freddie was already on it, and she took him off. Mr. Freddie was on the signature card on some of them. I was never on anything.
No, you all refused to be on anything.
Not on the bid, not on the signature cards. I was never given a check. Never given a check.
Because I made the statement at one of the meetings that why are we down here? We're not down here for the city. Now right is right. So I made that statement and y'all did refuse to sign checks. And you did say that you would be on the committee of the fire department.
Yes, ma'am, right. Not just the fire department.
Just the fire department.
Right.
And Council Denver said that he would, he didn't want to be on any committee. But that was by choice.
Right, and that was different.
But I know it was different, but that's what I'm saying. It was different once you had to be mayor pro tem. I mean, you had to step in for the mayor. Then it became different.
And so that's why I say perception is everything. The thing is, when you say you don't want to be included on anything except, then you took it to mean you didn't want to be involved with anything except the fire department. And that's what I can attest to what Councilwoman Whitman was saying.
That's fine. I don't have any problem. As long as we can get our check signed, payroll, and everything out, if you would let Ms. Toad see this, you or her can sign these checks. You or her, or Mr. Smallwood. Y'all's name is on the Squash account, and this man is here tonight. He would very much like to, you know, be paid so he can finish this job. Now, he's through with the job 3 weeks ago. And it is not the same check. It's a different check.
We need to let Council look at this.
Certainly.
Council, he's the finance chair. You need to look at that.
Let me ask you a question, please. As far as the payroll is going to be, yeah, there are days if I don't have payroll that I don't have the best day. When I'm not having a good day, I don't even dress up. I stay around the house. The chief is bringing those payroll checks out there. I got no problem signing payroll checks. I say, the only thing is, if you bring my head outside, bring me a check off list. Don't then bring up about the check and say, sign these. I want to check the list to see who's getting what. A lot of times people come back and sign a check. And the problem we've been having for years is not accountability, is that so many of us are asked to sign a check by the clerk. And when you sign the check, everything is blocked for where you're supposed to sign it. Now we don't do that. But the initial check, you did not tell your mind. You just see where you put your name. I won't go into that.
Him off. Mr. Freddie was on the signature card on some of them. I was never on anything.
No, you are refused to be on anything.
Not on this, not on the signature cards. I was never given
to
sign a check.
Y'all refused to sign any checks.
Never given a
because
check.
Because I made the statement at one of the meetings that why are we down here? We're not down here for the city. Now, right is right. So I made that statement, and y'all did refuse to sign checks. And you did say that you would be on the committee of the fire department.
Yes, ma'am, right. Not just the fire department.
Just the fire department.
Right.
And Council Denver said that he didn't want to be on any committee. But that was by choice.
Right, and that was different.
But I know it was different, but that's what I'm saying. It was different once you had to be mayor pro tem. I mean, you had to step in for the mayor. Then it became different.
And so that's why I say perception is everything. The thing is, when you say you don't want to be included on anything except, then you took it to mean you didn't want to be involved with anything except the fire department. And that's what I can attest to what Councilwoman Whitman
saying. That's fine. I don't have any problem. As long as we can get our check signed, payroll, and everything out, if you would let Ms. Toad see this, you or her can sign these checks. You or her, or Mr. Smallwood. Y'all's name is on the Squash account, and this man is here tonight. He would very much like to, you know, be paid so he can finish this job. Now, he's through with the job 3 weeks ago. And it is not the same check. It's a different check.
We need to let Council look at this.
Certainly.
Council, he's the finance chair. You need to look at that.
Let me ask you a question, please. As far as the payroll is going to be, yeah, there are days if I don't have payroll that I don't have the best day. When I'm not having a good day, I don't even dress up. I stay around the house. The chief is bringing those payroll checks out there. I got no problem signing payroll checks. I say, the only thing is, if you bring my head outside, bring me a check off list. Don't then bring up about the check and say, sign these. I want to check the list to see who's getting what. A A lot of times people come down and sign a check. And the problem we have, we've been having for years, is not accountability, is that so many of us are asked to sign a check by the clerk. And when you sign the check, everything is blocked the way you're supposed to sign it. Now we don't do that. But the initial check, who did not tell you about it? You just see where you put your name. I won't go into that.
Hey.
Mr. David Ewing with ADP. Please.
I'd like to keep this kind of short and sweet. I'm just going to hand this to everybody. Is anybody familiar with ADP up here?
No.
No? Automated data processing. We handle back office solutions for companies. Payroll, tax filing. Insurance services.
We got it.
What I'd rather do, if we can, is schedule an executive meeting. Is that possible?
No, sir.
No, no. Sir.
Again, don't do that.
Y'all have a good one. Thanks.
Thank you.
We have Auditor Malden here. Could you come down and elaborate, please, about automatic data processing?
My name is Miller Edwards, and the mayor asked me to come here to see if you all had any questions relative to the outsourcing payroll. I think outsourcing payroll makes sense in a lot of governments. It makes sense in business. Payroll takes a lot of time by people and interrupts a lot of the qualitative element of their work. They have to run payroll often and deal with all the quarterly reports and all those kind of things. It's a task. Now, I know you've got people who have been doing it for years. I'm sure they've gotten good at it. But it is one of those kind of things that when it comes to buying for buck, most of my clients, and we serve about 300 governments, very much, I'd say at least 90% of them outsource their payroll. And we're talking governments that are small, like the town of Whitesburg or somebody like that, all the way to Gwinnett County. And again, a lot of businesses out there do. I mean, there are businesses out there that might only have two people employed, and they still use an outsourced party like an ADP. I'm not here to support ADP. But it is a very cost-beneficial product or service. It also helps with controls, and I cannot help but sit here tonight, this evening, and sense, might be the word, a lack of trust, a lack of respect, and concern over controllers. And I think when you've got a community that has a small office of people who, those people are doing accounting, they're doing human resources, they're doing all kind of other admin duties, they're cutting checks. When you do that, the trick is to try to find a way to have cost beneficial, good internal controls. An ADP type party, an outsourced party, does provide a certain element of controls involved in doing this. I know there's concerns about the direct depositing and, you know, giving up bank account information, all that. Lord, we had the same thing at Baldwin Jenkins 15 years ago. We went to direct deposit our payroll. I'd have to say, I was a little suspicious. I mean, I'm about to give people information I don't even know. Well, things have changed in this world we live in. And I can tell you, as an employee of Baldwin Jenkins, it is incredibly convenient to not have to go grab my check, stand in line, and make a deposit. Especially if I'm out of town or running around somewhere, it's not that convenient. So from that standpoint, I can see it being a good thing. But of course, there's all kinds of ways to skin the cat. A lot of these outsourced parties, they don't have to use direct deposit. They can even do things like process your payroll and issue checks. The check would say City of Gordon, with maybe a little logo of like ADP or whoever the outsourced party is, would be owned there. They'd be the ones actually cutting the checks. By them cutting the checks, we now have another party involved in helping establish controls. And that's just something to think about, is trying to find ways that are cost-beneficial enhancements of controls. And a small community, a small government, and you all are that, that becomes difficult to do sometimes. It's real hard. You know, as an auditor, we can write up management points and findings all the time and talk about how you can do better with internal controls, but sometimes it's not cost beneficial. You can't all of a sudden take a community this size and say, well, we want to have your office have seven people in it. Seven people so you can have the perfect internal control structure. But what you can do is try to engineer what you do and how you do it to do your best remote, good sound, safekeeping and controls. And I do think outsourcing payroll is one step in being able to do that. Along with many other things. I mean, tonight I've heard y'all talk about who's on the bank accounts. I've got no problem with it being a person on the city council. I do have a problem with someone being able to write checks who also has all the administrative and accounting input as you have here with your short staff of people. But for anybody to be able to do debits and credits to the system and all the funds and move things around like that and still be the one that can cut checks and sign them, that's a red flag in the world of auditing and looking at internal controls. You'd like to have somebody doing the accounting and then someone else writing the check and someone else signing the check. But we don't necessarily have that either. The movement of funds that I heard earlier tonight, movement of funds is not required by a resolution with Georgia Fund 1. None of my clients go through a resolution to do that. The resolution is how you spend the monies ultimately. All governments, cities, counties, water authorities, whatever it might be, most of them in Georgia have a Georgia Fund 1 account. It's a great place to park money for a short period of time or even a long period of time based on rates and the convenience factor of getting that money. People wire money from Georgia Fund 1 to their operating account all the time. The controls, and remember we had this discussion back in February when you were talking about the budget. The control is how that money is ultimately spent. And that's where the budget is important. The budget is your legal level of control on how it's ultimately spent. Moving it from one bank account to another in the name of trying to put it in the right place so the checks can be issued. I've never had anyone have to go to city council to have movement of money from Georgia Fund 1.
We've always done it.
And that may be one of those things, that's what, if we've always done that way, I respect that. But I'm just telling you, it's not required to do it that way. The best thing to do
if it's not in the budget, let me explain one thing to you, Reed, and I say that. If it's not listed in our budget, when we begin our budget in October, if we do not have any money to be transferred out of the One Georgia Fund as our money to help cover the budget, nobody can change that budget except this council, including any funds that are moved.
Okay. And
what
I'm trying to tell you is, in the world of generally accepted accounting principles, and the idea of budgets, what you all do is not customary with the way other communities do these things.
We've already done it, okay?
I understand. I said I respect what you're talking about, but I'm trying to explain to you that that money...
We didn't ask for that explanation. We asked for you to just talk about this one thing.
Well, I was talking about it in the name of control.
But you know you're going past that.
Okay. I have gone past it.
Yes. I would rather you stick just for this one subject, please.
On this one subject, I think with Hanson's internal controls, that you did consider going outsourced with this type of operation.
Sir, yes, sir. The only thing about this now is we can't do it in the middle of the year, see? We have a guided budget. It is nothing in our budget. We did not plan for anything such as this. The time to do this is, you know, the upcoming year.
I respect that.
That's fine. And
you could always look at things at any interim point in time and consider doing an amendment.
Certainly.
But if it's not appropriate, it's not appropriate.
Sir, yes, sir.
But I do think, getting back to your question, I'm all about internal controls. You know, as an auditor, that's what I live and breathe, is looking at internal controls. And I do think outsourcing payroll, in light of the short staffing that we have in a community of this size, which I would expect to be short staffed in that respect, I would think you try to do anything you can to outsource certain things to help enhance your controls.
Certainly. I agree with that.
So that's where I'm coming from. Who you use, not my call. I'm just here to share and shed light on the concept.
Sir. There's proper time and place for all of it, but, you know, at the end of the year as we go into the new year.
I mean, I respect that.
Sure.
And to add to what you're saying, it doesn't matter, as you say with ADP, they are world-renowned, if I'm not mistaken, and I believe he shared that with me, that the previous bank, and I may be talking, you know, because I guess he felt the need, but with Mars Bank, they are now, I don't know who they're using, but they outsource theirs.
A lot of places.
The bank here in Gordon, direct
deposit. It's a win-win in most cases. Exactly. It helps promote controls, and it is cost-effective and efficient to do.
I know we can say with state government that that's the way we had. Ultimately, they educated us, they trained us, and like years ago, we were a bit apprehensive,
sure,
as to accepting it, but they assured us that if we didn't, I mean, they gave us the ultimatum that eventually you're going to have to, or either you get a car.
You're
so
right.
With this being said, as an administrative decision, this is something we want, is the control and trust and the integrity, which goes along.
I think it would be a good thing in that respect. I think most people involved would appreciate what's being attempted to happen.
Thank you so much. Is Mr. Mark Hardison available?